Medical Informatics group at the University of California, San Diego. She's going to be talking to us today about laboratory screening and trying to understand if 100% is the right number, the right goal for a quality measure. She'll be talking for about 30 minutes.
Hello, welcome, and thank you for having me here today. I'm really nice to see, I'm really glad to see a full room, and I'm ready to introduce you to my world, which really spends a lot of effort producing and analyzing clinical quality metrics. So I work on the side of the EHR where we're very involved in clinical practice and measuring what happens in the clinical practice and trying to determine if we have good quality or not. So, who defines quality? Well, the US government certainly has a role in that, and the payers who want to get value for their healthcare dollars, medical professional organizations and societies, and who have I left off this list who's the obvious person benefiting from medical quality?
Patients.
Patients, yes. Never forget the patients. So the Institute of Medicine defines quality of care as the degree to which the services match the knowledge that we have of what's supposed to be done in a particular instance. And the National Quality Measures Clearinghouse, which is sponsored by AHRQ, defines quality measures as mechanisms that help us establish whether or not we're meeting the quality goals. So what are we measuring? I think everybody who's started a program in the School of Biomedical Informatics in Foundation 1 knows about Dunabedian. I think that was like my very first assignment when I came here, is to write a little one-page paper of who is this guy. So I'm hoping you all know who he is. Who's never heard of him before? See, I knew it. So you all are very familiar with structure, process, and outcome. And that's the architecture that AHRQ has adopted to group and structure their measurements. So I love this site and use it frequently. It's the National Quality Measures Clearinghouse. So if I want to know what's the latest in terms of measuring a particular disease or lab test or whatever, I can come here and get lots of information about what other people are measuring. So, who do you think is measuring the most? Would it be, this is a chart that has context, clinical context on this side. So we have ambulatory care, we have inpatient, emergency, ancillary services, assisted living. So ambulatory is the place where measures are predominant in terms of our reporting requirements. And in terms of the domain, we have process measures, access and outcomes. So here's your Dunabedian columns right there. And, well, access is really sort of a different category. That's, can people afford, or are they in a locale where they can access services? So here's your process, outcome, and structure. And so the ambulatory process measures at 696 in this database are clearly far and away the largest category of measures currently being monitored today. And we take the monitoring very, very seriously because CMS, the driver of the payment for most of the elderly cohort in our country and many, many others, has incentivized that we produce these measures and perform well in order to receive payment. So there are programs like Meaningful Use, delivery system reform, incentive payments, bundled payment initiatives. This is a new payment model where the government will pay for a surgical procedure based on not only what happens in the operating room, but what happens post 90 days. So they're looking at, did you do a good job in the hospital? Did you do a good job with the recovery? Are they going to the right place for their rehab? So we have lots and lots of new payment models that are coming online that all require clinical reporting. And this is really the simple way of looking at it. It all boils down to who. So who will define from a, who will derive benefit from a given intervention? And the what is it that you're supposed to do to them? So that is the high level look. We have a formula for this. So the denominator is the number of patients in the risk group or the cohort, and that's the who. And the numerator is the count of the patients who receive the intervention, usually over some defined period of time. And then that results in a percentage, which is the metric that gets reported. So the title of my talk and the topic of my dissertation will focus on labs and laboratory quality measures. And why do I want to do that? I do work in the population health department, or it's a team really within the clinical systems group at UC San Diego. And we find labs are really a good starting point for population health because there's low risk of harm. If someone gets an extra lab test, they might be upset because they have to pay more, but generally there's very little risk involved in doing a blood draw or a sample collection. The data, both to order the lab and to report the lab, is discrete data, which is relatively easy to extract from the record. And so you know, without doing natural language processing or looking through the notes, that a doctor wanted this to be done, and with the resulting component, you know that it actually was done. There are existing agreements about what should be done. Sometimes those are dictated by the organizations who are funding the incentives. Sometimes they're through professional organizations within a clinical specialty. And sometimes it's just within your own clinical institution or your health enterprise. There's a general agreement or protocol that says what's supposed to be done in terms of lab monitoring. And there are known parameters for good and bad. So it's a really good, clean space in which to begin an analysis. It also fits into this chronic disease management model. This was published by Jeff Beach and all, and I've actually annotated this. This is a working document that we use to explain how the population team works with chronic care populations to engage them in care and monitor their health, so and improve their health or keep it from getting worse. So you start with recommendations. So that's the what. Who's supposed to get what? You've got those in evidence-based guidelines. You get those evidence-based guidelines into your EHR along with an actionable registry. So this is what we're doing today at UCSD. So instead of the registry living outside the EHR, it's actually a part of the electronic record system, which we have Epic. So we can capture, oh, if we want to know who are all our patients who are on warfarin, for instance, we have a report that runs right within Epic that can be called up on demand, and we have tools within the system to track when their last lab was taken and when it's next due. So we put those into the system to drive interventions, and when the labs are completed, we can evaluate the patient outcome. So the goal is to keep the patient healthy and have no adverse drug events. As we track these, monitor the patient outcomes, we could create a feedback loop through our quality system and revise the guidelines as appropriate. So this is an evolving process. It falls into continuous quality improvement. It falls under the topic of complex adaptive systems, because you have this whole setup that's engaged to deliver and monitor and correct the care on an ongoing basis. One of the applications I've been involved in is the monitoring of warfarin. Some of you may have been here in the spring when I spoke about developing the warfarin registry. Do any of you remember that? Dr. Cohen, I know you. Okay, so warfarin, also known as Coumadin, is a high-risk medication in that if you give too much, a patient can bleed. So here's a patient who's experiencing an uncontrolled bleed. They have to go to the emergency department. It's a very scary thing. It's an expensive thing. It's potentially life-threatening, and we don't want that to happen. And if they don't get enough of the medication, then typically they're given this medication to avoid getting clots. So they've had a pulmonary thrombosis, a PTE event, or some kind of clotting problem, so that they need to have their blood thinned. If they don't get enough of the medication, then they're at risk for getting another clot. And that's more or less what this chart says. The interesting thing about this is that it happens a lot, okay? So 900,000 incident or recurrent fatal and non-fatal VTE events, so that's the stroke side of it. And then on this side, one-third of ER visits for adverse drug events are caused by warfarin. That's a lot of visits. So looking at the universe of metrics, we found one about INR monitoring. And this is not a metric that's been universally adopted by the government or by any group of institutions that I'm aware of, but it is out there that patients who are at least 18 at the beginning of the measurement period and they've been on warfarin for 56 days need to have this lab test, this INR test, every 56 days from there onward, as long as they're on warfarin. Now, when we presented this to our pharmacists, they're like, 56 days, that's not what we do. I think it should be more like 90, and there's a lot of discussion around this. So when I referred back to say that these protocols are generally accepted, some are more accepted than others, okay? So everybody agrees the warfarin should be monitored through the INRs. Not everybody agrees how often it should be done. So going back to the lab workflows, what has to happen in order for a patient to get their lab? So this is a basic flowchart approach. I did this in my first year of study here. When we looked at, well, we're starting, we know this patient has to have a visit. Did the patient show up for their visit? Well, if they did, that's great. We'll check if their INRs do, but if they didn't show up, they probably don't have an order because we didn't see them, right? If they showed up and we realized that the INR is due, was it ordered? Well, sometimes the doctor is very busy. The patient isn't even in because they need an INR. They're in because they need a flu shot or they need something else. They have a sprained ankle. They forgot to check their INR while they were in, so it wasn't ordered. They go home without it. If there's an INR order, the patient may get the INR right then and there in their appointment, or they may be told to go to the laboratory and take it tomorrow or next week or whatever. So does the patient show up at the lab? Maybe, but sometimes not. So if they show up at the lab, a sample needs to be collected, it needs to be resulted in a laboratory, interface back to Epic. Sometimes there's some technical things that can go wrong. If we get a result in Epic, we're done. Yay, this patient goes into the numerator of our metric. In Dr. Collins' class, we learned about agent-based modeling and state-based modeling. And we can use that to look at this with another layer of complexity, because it's not just that you need an event to happen. The lab was done or it wasn't done, you know, in a Boolean type of analysis. We have these different people and items, the physical items that need to be at a certain place, at a certain time, in a certain order, in order to make this process work. And I won't go through the whole thing, but we're tracking over time. So this is more or less the same workflow that I showed in the flowchart format, but we've added a scheduler because we need a scheduler to put the patient on the doctor's schedule to get a medical visit. We have a provider because the provider is necessary to sign the order. We have to have an actual order in the system so that itself becomes its own entity. And the last red one is a phlebotomist. We need somebody to draw the blood. And then we have the patient start state, and they can go through. And each one of these states has a probabilistic value of whether you're going to transition into the next state or which state you're going to transition into. So I like the concept of modeling the process, thinking that when you're comparing departments and institutions, there's very, very little overlap or consistency in the structure of the organizations or the process. So in order for this to be replicable or transferable of use to other organizations, we need to use an approach that allows us to plug in the specifics at a particular locale in order to determine how the outcome will be impacted if we change some of the processes. And basically, I like to use this chart to think about how an intervention works. So basically, you have your probabilities of getting from the start to the end. If you add another intervention, so say 80% get an order and 20% don't get an order. If this is the place where people are falling off track and falling out of this process, and you put in an automated bulk ordering intervention, then you can increase the likelihood to perhaps 100% that this order gets completed. So you can determine how those interventions work on your end numbers by tweaking the percentages of completion with health information technology support. So that's the end of the complicated part. Are there any questions at this point? Because I wanted to engage you a little bit in doing a guessing game. So
why did you put it in at the end stage when you know that even if the results get back, sometimes they're not ever acted on?
That is a simplification for the sake of example, but that's ultimately true.
The measure just looks at whether the test was done.
Yeah, there are measures if it was done or not done.
The thing about measures, there's lots of bad measures. Okay.
Yes. Exactly. So how do we know if we're doing a good job? Well, again, I refer back to the National Measures Clearinghouse, and they have another table on this, and they tell us how the measures are evaluated in a column called Standard of Comparison. Okay? So there's an internal time comparison. So I call that more of the same, okay? So over a given period of time, is your percentage this year better than your percentage last year? Okay? So that's one way that you can monitor your result and trend it. Are we getting better? Are we getting worse or stay the same? Another is external time comparison, either with a snapshot or a trend. So you're looking at the guy down the street, and I call this the better than you approach. Okay? So our health system is 85, but your health system is 79. So we're better than you, right? That is also a common method of comparison. And the last one is a prescriptive standard, which is we know what's best and we're going to tell you what number you have to meet. So let's take a show of hands. How many think that this number is above 25% or below 25%? More of the same.
Four.
Oh, okay, I'll have to call it out. Okay. Okay, so of all the measures, so we have 600 measures, well, actually this was based on 1,000 measures. So out of 1,000 measures, we'll do this another way, out of 1,000 measures, how many of those measures, I'll make it easier, out of 100 measures, how many of those measures are evaluated, compared using the internal time comparison? We did better than we did last year. So let's throw out some numbers. Out of 100.
5%.
5%. Okay.
By the standard or internally? Internally, they always do that.
No, by the AHRQ clearinghouse standard. So whoever the sponsoring organization is. So external to them. Don't know. Okay. Do you think more of them are being done compared internally or externally?
I think probably more internal than external.
More internal than external. And how many do you think we have that are working to a prescriptive standard? Any ideas about what percentage they have to meet a particular standard across the nation, a national standard? Huh? Your money goes there. Interesting. Interesting exercise. They're the numbers. Okay? So 8% of these measures in the AHRQ clearinghouse have a national number that you're supposed to meet. 34% of them are comparing you against your peers. And 58% are, we're doing better than last year. So this is the easy question. How many think that this is a scientific approach to setting a target? Crickets, okay. I agree with you completely. So, so that is the problem in a nutshell. What is the appropriate target for a lab-based quality intervention? I'm preparing to advance to candidacy in December, and I'm working on my proposal, and these are the things that Dr. Sittig has helped me hone in on that I'll be focusing on. Government and payer mandated reporting of lab quality metrics. Quality goals are currently set based on improvement over previous performance, and we'll develop a conceptual model for setting these quality targets, considering the cost of the intervention, outcomes of the testing, and inherent variability in the process. So this is in line, this is important because as we move into more capitated care models, the payers are becoming more and more interested in determining quality as outcome measures as opposed to process measures, and learning the value of the quality per the cost. We had a situation where we were looking at how many people got followed up after a hospital discharge within 7 days. you know, there's a range of performance, and we were comparing with an external group, and oh, that hospital system over there, they've got really, really high marks. What did they do to get it? They send their doctors to each person's home, okay? So there are variations in the cost of the interventions that one can make in order to hit these quality targets. And some of them can become quite expensive. And some of them are setting up systems whereby the incremental cost of adding another measure is small compared to setting up the system. So looking at some preliminary data, there are different reasons that you would monitor for monitor lab tests, and they may have different risk profiles. So we'll be considering medication monitoring. Just can the medication cause a problem, like warfarin? Monitoring risk factors like LDL, your cholesterol levels. Monitoring disease progression, like viral load for HIV, or your A1C test is a disease progression measure for diabetes, and screening for infectious disease. So these might not all be the same in terms of how they operate within these models. And then, but the workflows around laboratory testing tend to be similar across disease states and across organizations. They can provide snapshots and trending. And we've done a little bit of this, just showing that after we put in the anticoagulation registry, and this is thanks to my visualization class in Tableau, median elapsed time since the last INR. So should we be looking at individuals, or should we be looking at, you know, there's another way of looking at performance of a group. So maybe the overall days, the gap between when you last had your test and when you next had your test, it's narrowing. Maybe you didn't quite meet the target, but we're still moving in the right direction. So that's one way of looking at it. We're looking at, this is more of an outcome measure where the INR values appear that they might be decreasing. And I do add the caveat that this is preliminary data. It's just a quick look, so we're not statistically sure that there is an improvement, but these are just intriguing visualizations that can help us conceptualize what might be happening. And then here's another one where we see that this is overplotted, but this is a plot of the INR values at given points in time. So the higher the top one, that's the outlier. That's the maximum value as of that month. And so you can see that there's kind of this trending where the outliers are reducing in magnitude and severity until here, and then they pop up again, even though the averages kind of look like they're moving in the same direction. We still have some possibly serious issues with a couple of outliers. Well, yes, I qualify that because in our health system, we have an anticoag clinic that monitors 900 patients, and then we have two family medicines that monitor about 300 each, and then the rest of the providers are like other. They're not within this context of using the registry. And then maybe we need to be looking at some other things, like we're finding that the ICD coding really doesn't give us good visibility of adverse drug events. We're looking at maybe, you know, finding the administration of antidotes, for instance, or curative measures to reverse bleeding. So there is work in this area through the study of adverse drug events, and we'll have to be looking at that too if we want to look at outcome measures, because it's a lot harder to find outcomes than it is to find laboratory measures. So I've used up my time, and I thank Dr. Siddig and all my advising committee, Dr. Cohen, Dr. Franklin, and I'm announcing a new external member on my committee that you haven't all met yet. But Dr. Amy Siddipati is my boss at UCSD. She has created the population health team within the clinical systems group. She's now the director of population health, and I was a founding member of that team in January. We are up to 3 analysts, and we have really bridged this functional gap between what the provider sees in, we call it hyperspace and epic, but what the doctor interacts with in the clinic and the reporting side, which is to be an entirely separate department, and they do the clinical reporting, and it would go out to the payers, and the providers would never see it. So we're using these tools to create these feedback loops so that the providers can not only see, but have tools giving them efficiencies of scale to move the metrics in the right direction.
Thank you.
Well, that would be nice, but that's not directly my hypothesis. My hypothesis is, or when I'm the question, and I haven't really formulated it in just a hypothesis, is what process should you employ to develop a target for your lab measurements? Thank you.
Thank you so much. You can find the delay.
Right. So, thanks for that. The next speaker is Chen Liang. He'll be talking about his work on patient safety, specifically trying to change the effectiveness of error reporting systems using knowledge modeling. I should say also that I'm not his advisor. His advisor is Yang Gok. Somewhat responsible for anything that's wrong with the presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Cohen. So my name is Chen. Just 1 minute. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about the patient safety issues. So, as you all know, this is an important issue and has been catching increasing attention from the recent years. So, the patient safety is a relatively new discipline that has some concerns about the patient incident report and the data analysis and how to generate the actionable knowledge for the clinicians. So WHO and HRQ in the United States have launched a few very important projects to try to improve the patient safety. Like in 2005, WHO launched a project named International Classification for Patient Safety, and AHRQ also released a lot of research grants to support the patient safety research. So these words, like these terms, like error, near miss, and unsafe conditions, are what we are familiar with in patient safety related fields. And even though we have put so much money in to improve the patient safety event, to improve the patient safety and reduce patient harms, still we found that there was a report last year that's saying there are something between 210,000 to 440,000 patients died because of preventable medical errors. So this is a sign that to alert us that patient safety still need continuous attention in research and also in practice. So oftentimes we put the patient safety reporting system in the center of the discussion to improve the patient safety. So here I show you the workflow or the pipeline of the patient safety report. So basically every clinician in the hospital or healthcare settings, they they can report anonymously any incident, so a patient harm related issues, and report that event into the like a reporting system. And in this system, we have a knowledge base, and it's actually serves as a classification system that can use to screen those events into different categories, appropriate categories. So, and then we the backend users retrieve those data and information from this knowledge base, and then by using this data, they can do the data analysis, and so they can know what kind of issues are recurring a lot, and they try to generate actionable knowledge and some preventive measures to stop the harm from happening in the future. And this is the general idea for the patient safety report. And among this system, I think, from my knowledge, I thought the knowledge base is one of the critical component in the system. This is because the system intends to learn from the previous cases. And the issue is that issue we are facing that is we are having a lot of tremendous amount of the data coming in the system every day, and but we don't have enough like human labors or production times to process this data and to use this data to generate valuable information and knowledge. So I think I will put the classification, actually the knowledge base, into the center of my research. So then this is the classification issue. So in the raw data, we found there are a lot of like concepts and terms that we can find from the patient safety reports, and mostly they are encoded in free text. So there is a lot of like chaos and noise. So we can find that, for example, the dosing, MRI, pressure ulcer, fracture, skin tear, patient fall, diagnostic error, stuff like that, concept and terms. And the issue that we have no idea how to classify these terms and concepts into appropriate classes. So the idea is we try to build up a classification, at least on a concept level, and then categorize these terms and the concepts into appropriate classes, like this, these circles. Then the big circle denotes the patient safety concept in general. And then we're supposed to have a few small circles in here. And for example, this circle I drew here is the patient outcomes. And they can, for example, we found skin tear, fracture, pressure ulcer, they're supposed to be the sort of under the concept of patient outcomes. So we named them, labeled them as patient outcomes. So we can also find some very similar circles in the patient safety concept in general. And the issue for the classification system for now is can be included into 3 points. And the first one is the lack of a uniform classification system. Because we have a lot of different hospitals, they use different systems, actually different classifications to categorize those terms and concepts. And we are, most of the system are based, some of them are based on papers, just fill up the paper forms and sending into the archive, and it's very hard to use them to generate useful information. And so there is a limited capacity of processing semantic data, and also there is another drawback that there is a less attention on further analysis on patient safety events because. The overarching goal for the incident reporting and patient safety research is to generate actionable knowledge that can prevent future patient harm. So this is the proposed solution I put here. So we are trying to build a patient safety classification. And the way we build this classification is that we use a kind of formal language to build this classification. We call it ontology. So ontology is actually a hierarchical and structure that can encode all the entities. And also, it can also represent the relationships between those entities in abstract graphical format. So this is these two pictures show the critical contribution that ontology can make. The first one is a hierarchical classification. The second one is a multi-label classification. These two issues are critical in patient safety classification. That's because in the real world, most of the cases, those concepts and terms can be, they are organized in a hierarchical way and also in a multi-label way. So these two issues can also be a research question in the domain of like machine learning and data mining. And so this is the main reason we're trying to use ontology to solve the problem. So, and this is what we have done in the last semester. So we try to use, because those terms and the concepts to represent patient safety are not come from nowhere. We use the international classification for patient safety that are developed by WHO and the common formats that are developed by AHRQ to generate the ontology we are going to use. So because in ICPS and common formats, there are a lot of terms and concepts used to describe and define the different concepts and the terms in describing patient safety events. So we actually extract those terms and concepts from these two systems, and we incorporate the two systems together and make them ontological structure. So, and then after that, we performed an evaluation procedure. So in the evaluation procedure, we asked domain experts to use our generated ontology to review. You use the ontology to review the real-world cases. And in the meantime, they're going to take a survey. And so the survey will cover many aspects of the, through the validity and the reliability of an ontology. So for example, if I am an expert, domain expert, and I try to review a patient incident that returned in free text, and then when I finished reviewing it, I will use the ontology to see if any concepts and terms can be covered by this ontology. If most of the terms and concepts can be covered by the ontology, and most of them can be found in appropriate way, and the wording and the organization and the hierarchical structure all make sense, then they will probably turning a lot of positive answers in that survey instrument. So we're still working on the evaluation part, but for now we already saw a positive trending in the preliminary data. And then the next step, we are going to fill up the ontology and link this ontology with the real world data. The real world data means the free text reports. And so the way we do this is that we annotate those terms and concepts from the free text. And then we try to find the appropriate classes in ontology for these annotated terms and concepts. And then we link the annotated data and the ontological classes together. Then we, by doing this, we make ontology sort of complete. And this is also ever growing work because the data is growing and ontology, the new terms and concepts can merge anytime, all the time. So this is a piece of work we are trying to do for this semester. So because we found some drawbacks for the traditional ways we classify the documents, incident reports, And for example, there is a rather large feature space if you are using a machine learning-based method to classify the patient safety reports. And we also found the complexity and the very significant runtime in processing the data. And also the traditional way, which is mostly based on the Berkovich hypothesis assumption, kind of ignore the similarity between the related concepts. That's why we need the input of the ontology. So, and we believe that the ontology can make a contribution here. And it can, in details, it can improve the feature selection, and it can also add some semantic similarities into the document classification. And this slide shows what we are trying to do to use ontology to improve the feature ranking. So the one measure we are trying to calculate here is the information gain. And information gain actually measures the correlation between a feature and a class. After that, based on the measure of information gain, we have actually two options. The traditional one is that we only consider the number of documents where a given feature is present or absent. And this way, it doesn't calculate, put the relationship between the concept into account. So it has some drawbacks. And the way we are actually using is the second one. And we will consider the number of documents where a given feature or any of its children are present or absent. So we will. So this is why the ontology can make a contribution here. So, and based on the measure of information gain, we rank the feature by the information gain. And this is the second piece of work we are trying to use ontology to improve the classification. And we will calculate the semantic similarity. So here are a few concepts here. The first one is similarity. So we know that any given words, two concepts in the documents can have some sort of similarity, but not all of them are what we need. We only need the relevant similarity, which is the one that increases the performance of a given classifier. So that means similarity can contribute to the classification task we will need. And the second, the other concept is that information content. We use this information content to measure the similarity. So the information content is calculated based on the frequency of a concept and the frequency of all its children in a corpus. And the third concept I'm going to introduce is a least common subsumer, LCS. So here is a figure here that can give an example. So for example, we are trying to figure out the LCS between boat and automobile. So first, we will find the ancestor of the boat and automobile. Oh, sorry, the boat and a car, actually. So we're trying to figure out what is the ancestor of the boat and a car. So when we look at the automobile, it is not an ancestor because it's the ancestor of the car, but it's not for the boat. So we go on and look into the vehicle. We find this is the target we are looking for, and also the object. So. But the issue is that which one is the least common consumer? That means this term means we are trying to find the closest ancestor in measure of distance between the boat and the car. So the vehicle is the closest, and the object is far from vehicle. So in this scenario, vehicle is the CLS for boat and car. So and the way we are doing this piece of work is that we will measure the if we are trying to figure out whether it is a relevant similarity between boat and car, we are trying to first we figure out what is the LCS for boat and car, and then we will measure the information gain for the vehicle, see if this is relevant. It is relevant to the class we are supposed to use for the classification. So, and we will set a certain threshold in there. And if the information gain go up to the threshold, and we will say that, okay, this vehicle is necessary, is a relevant similarity. So we will measure, we'll use IC to measure the similarity between boat and car. If it doesn't get the threshold, then we will assign it a similarity of zero. So then we will project this kernel method to project the pairwise similarity into a feature space. So it's supposed to help our classification task. So, after all this work have been done, let's go back to the reality. So the reality that this example came from a study like years before, and the data set is from a university hospital, which is associated with a patient safety organization. So we found they have 2919 patient incidents through 1 year. And then these patients, this report has been already typed into the reporting system. But we used a lot of like domain experts to recategorize these incidents. And we found that, here is an example. So we found that in terms of incident type, we found that originally there were like a 33% of, in terms of incident type, are labeled as miscellaneous. And after the recategorizing, we found that the number reduced to like only 20%. So that means we found like there are 12% of the miscellaneous data is actually can be categorized appropriately into a certain category. So, and in terms of the error description, we also used the recategorization, and we found that there are 4% of the unwitnessed from others category that can be categorized into patient fall. So that means we have a lot of existing data that are not categorized appropriately, or put the other way, we need some like more artificial ways or automated ways to do the job. So this is where I think our work can make a contribution here. And we also discovered some challenges in our current work. So for example, the selection, the first one and a very, very important one is the selection of the background knowledge base. Because it's all relying, the feature selection and the similarity all relying on the ontology, relying on how to generate the ontology. So it actually involves a lot of human labors in the construction work. And this is very important because we need domain experts. We need their expertise, like clinicians, front-end clinicians. We need their input into the design of the ontology. And the second one would be, it's actually the future work. We need to run more experiments on machine learning methods to test whether to compare between methods. Because some of the methods are supervised, some of the methods are unsupervised, and they may result in different performance for the classifier. So we need some solid data to demonstrate our hypothesis. And the take-home message here is that we are trying to build an ontology knowledge base that which provides a uniform classification for the patient safety events. And we are going to use this ontology to improve the feature selection and the semantic similarity. And eventually, we'll get a better performance for the classification, document classification. And all the thanks go to my colleagues and the grant agents. And I would like to take questions, if any.
So do you ever think about patient safety events that are caused by health information technology?
Yes, actually, when I tried to review the literature, well, I found a lot of errors actually caused by the HIT.
You did?
I did.
In those reports, did you find any?
Yes.
2900?
Yes, because as I just said previously, many different hospitals use different categorization. And I found that some of the hospital, they have they set up categorized for specifically for the HIT, and like a medical device and some information exchange sort of like a system, and there are a lot of errors in there. Yes, please.
How do you handle when an event might fall into multiple categories?
Oh yes, this is the reason, one of the reasons why we're trying to use Ontology, because Ontology can handle the like multi-label issues. And that's why this is also a kind of drawback for the traditional like machine learning based classification. So we're specifically trying to focusing on the multi-label issues. Thank you. Yes, please.
So the Ontology, when you build an Ontology or pick an Ontology or learn an Ontology, the right one depends on how you're going to use it. I didn't quite get how you're going to use it. You mentioned problems several times, but I see several potential problems. I'm not sure which one you're focusing on.
Oh. Right, I didn't make it very clear, because we are trying to build an ontology, but the application for the ontology is not limited to only for the classification task. This is only like a user case that we want to share with you. And there are also other approaches that we can use the ontology. For example, all the issues currently here we have is coming from the low quality of that incoming data. So one of our overarching goals is to try to solve the data source. We're trying to build up ontology, and the ontology is supposed to guide the data entry part. So this is the other project that we have.
Are you focusing on patient safety, or are you focusing on ontologies and learning ontologies with an existing ontology?
Focusing on ontology, and we try to figure out a lot of efficient ways that we can improve the patient safety from the perspective of informatics. And we found that, for example, other fields in the medical biomedical, there are a lot of gene ontology and also vaccine ontology. They've been using for a long time, and we found there is like a very little amount of the efforts have been put into the patient safety domain. So we're trying to take the chance of using ontology to improve patient safety. So, but our primary focus is patient safety. Yes, please.
So I was thinking, when you classify, if I'm in the field, so I'm going to be able to take your classification,
right,
and I'm going to be able to, what is your idea on how I'm
going to
use it if I'm in the field? How am I
going to use it? So the first thing that you need to agree with the classification, because if you take a different opinion, you might not going to want to use the classification. So assume that you agree with the classification we are trying to generate. Then the next step, we have multiple options. The first one is that I just trying to explain to the Dr. Johnson, is that we are trying to improve the data quality. So when you, for example, if you are a clinician, you can use the ontology to guide your data entry when you want to report an incident. So you know which, for example, you are reporting like pressure ulcer case, you know this might go to the patient harm, what is the appropriate place you want to put in the patient car, the patient outcome, and what is the appropriate place you want to play in the medical error, the human factors, or something like the different healthcare settings. You know where to put your case, and this is the one application. The other application that, for example, you are also a healthcare management. You are a leader in the hospital, and your responsibility is to analyze those incidents on your desk, and then you would want to know which kind of cases happen a lot every week, like every month, and burn a lot of money and cause a lot of patient harm, and you want to find out that. And the issue is that you have so many incidents on your desk, so no way you can work like 5 hours to look into all of them. So the way is that you want to look into our system, which is guided by the ontology, and you can very easily find what you want. And then you will know where is the reason, and you will get together your people and your men and let them to do some action to prevent the harm.
Well, I'm excited about your program because
right.
You get this going, because I'm going to tell you that's what we did have to do. We would use something like Taproot to try to classify them, to try to decide, is this a communication problem, is this a, and then to try to figure out and put it in a category to then try to develop some program to change this problem or some process. But we never had a classification to be able to do it. So when someone like Joint Commission came along and said, well, how many of these do you have? We didn't have a classification. We just had
okay.
to do them by themselves. So it would be great.
Yeah. I feel like most of the hospitals use like a relational database to use to store the data. And they have a very simple structured categorization, but may not be that fancy. But I say this might be a scientific fiction or something, but
it's just
an idea. You know,
no, I think it's good because the issue is that, again, we're looking at once you classify, what am I going to, I want to know what classification is so I can do something, right? I want to improve the event, right? I don't want the event to happen again. I don't want to report this to Joint Commission. Anymore.
Right, right.
So right now we didn't really have a classification.
Right. That's what we actually really need, because I only have like engineering stuff in my mind, so I need to hear the voice from the clinicians and what they need, their desire. Thank you.
Quick question. So, is the idea that new error reports would be annotated with your ontology?
Yes, I'm trying to implement that, but I found a lot of challenges in that. I didn't have enough time to detail them. So a lot of like the technical difficulties.
Yeah. And then probably you.
Right.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Hoping that I'm not just not